Hey, it's ShadowACS again. Today's anime is kind of an important milestone because it's the second anime to be released in America as a Netflix exclusive. The first one being Knights of Sidonia, which I didn't see because, I have to be honest, I had never even heard of it. While Netflix has had anime available for streaming for a long time, this was one of their first exclusives. So to help break into the market, they decided to go with what in my opinion was a really smart choice, a popular shounen crowd pleaser. So let's take a look at The Seven Deadly Sins. Seven Deadly Sins was an anime I definitely did hear about, even aside from it just being groundbreaking as one of the first Netflix anime. It's gotten hugely popular in the year since its release, getting a second season and OVA, and it looks like there's even more to come. I was kind of aware of the premise, and I did want to see it for a while. It just seemed like a good old-fashioned fun fantasy story, maybe a little cheesy, but the kind of story where you can get away with that. And I'm happy to say that's exactly what it delivered. This is an incredibly fun, silly shounen anime, and it absolutely embraces every second of it. I'll admit, when I set out to do this review, I was initially going to dismiss it as just really good-tasting junk food. Just sort of a mindless, fun waste of time without that much substance. But the more I thought about it, there is a lot of depth to this world and these characters, and there's a lot of creativity, and the story is well told, and you know what? This is a great anime! Just because it's incredibly over-the-top and kind of immature doesn't mean it isn't good. It might actually be one of my new favorites. Normally, whenever an anime is several dozen episodes long, I kind of worry that I'm not going to be able to finish it in time to do a review. And if it turns out to be really bad, well, that's just more misery I have to put myself through. But with Seven Deadly Sins, I had no problem watching several episodes a sitting. It's just so well-paced and so much fun that I didn't want to stop watching it. So let's take a look at what it's about. This is another one where I'm going to make a personal recommendation to watch the first episode before continuing this review, because the episode ends on a pretty awesome twist that unfortunately I do have to spoil. The show takes place in a pretty basic medieval fantasy world filled with knights, sword fighting, giants, fairies, all sorts of mystical and magical stuff. Years ago, there existed a legendary powerful group of fighters known as the Seven Deadly Sins, who became fugitives and disappeared after an alleged attempt to overthrow the kingdom. The story begins with a girl named Elizabeth, the princess of the kingdom, wandering into a small tavern owned by a curious, diminutive young man, as well as his sidekick, a talking pig named Hawk. Elizabeth tells the young man that she's looking for the Seven Deadly Sins because they were apparently framed as part of a nefarious plot by the Holy Knights of the kingdom to usurp her father, and she hopes that the Sins might be the only ones powerful enough to stop them. But when one of the knights catches up to her and threatens to take her back to her father dead or alive, it seems all is lost. Until the young man reveals to her that he is in fact Meliodas, the former captain of the Seven Deadly Sins. He defeats her assailant with ease and decides to go on a journey with her to find and reunite the other Sins and stop the Holy Knights. So the show on the surface does sound like a very basic traditional fantasy, but its over-the-top style is what really stands out about it and what makes it so much fun. Like the fact that one of the characters is a talking pig with no explanation. Or the fact that the pig's mother also happens to be a giant walking green hilltop that's also the tavern Meliodas works at. Again, it's never explained. I love how random that is. Or the fact that one of the Sins is a giant girl named Deanne who doesn't act all booming and menacing like you'd expect from a more traditional giant. She acts like any other teenage girl who just happens to be 30 feet tall. It's unique, fun choices like that that make this anime so memorable. The action is absurdly over the top, and in the best way. This is the kind of show where a character can somehow cut an entire forest in half with one swing of a sword, and that's just a regular thing for them. The way the show just embraces the insanity of how over the top it can make its action scenes is hard not to have fun with. And like any other great shounen, every character has their own unique power and fighting style that makes them stand out. Like Meliodas, for example, fights with a tiny broken sword and yet is still somehow able to easily defeat people with giant weapons. There's no explanation for how he does it other than he's just that good. There's also another one of the Sins named Bon who literally can't die. Yeah, you keep expecting them to point out some kind of weakness or technicality, like with zombies, if you take their head off, they don't come back. But no, there's parts where he gets incinerated and blown to a million pieces and yet he still just comes back like nothing ever happened. I love stuff like this because not only does it make the action stand out more, it makes the characters stand out more. Every time they introduce a new character, I keep wanting to see what kind of crazy creative idea they're going to try next. And that's another thing, the characters are amazing! Every one of the Seven Deadly Sins is a completely unique character. They all have their own backstories and powers and something about them to stand out. I always love anime like this that focus on a group or a team of characters where we can constantly see and absorb their interactions off each other. But usually there's at least one character I consider a favorite, and the others I just kinda get bored whenever they're on screen. Here, I loved every single one of these guys. If you were to ask me who my favorite of the Seven Deadly Sins was, I honestly couldn't tell you. They're just all so great. And none of them feel like they get too much or too little screen time. They're all balanced out perfectly throughout the story. They all have great backstories. They all have different personalities. Their interactions off each other are so much fun. You get to know them so well, you can easily point out what every single character feels about every other one. Even the friggin' pig is likable. I love how he's always delusionally boasting about how powerful he is, when really he's just a pig with nothing special about him except that he can talk. They haven't revealed too much about the backstory between him and Meliodas yet, and honestly, I kinda don't want them to. I just love the randomness of the idea that Meliodas met a talking pig and decided to make him his sidekick for no reason. It's so delightfully silly. If I was forced at gunpoint to name one weak link in this character cast, it'd probably be Princess Elizabeth. Which maybe isn't fair because she's still a good character. I like her fine as a love interest, she has a good backstory. She does a good job playing the straight woman to all these other crazy over-the-top characters. But as far as her personality goes, she's just sort of the kind-hearted, angelic love interest without any personal flaws. I don't know, if she was in a much worse anime, I probably wouldn't complain about her at all. But because of the fact that she's constantly surrounded by characters this good and this unique, I'm kind of forced to acknowledge her as the weak link in the chain, if only by default. I guess it's also fair to point out that Meliodas might piss some people off, as he is kind of the overpowered shounen main character, which is a trope that doesn't really annoy me, but I know does annoy a lot of other people. But what I really love about him is that for a lot of the show, there is a certain element of unpredictability to him. We know he's incredibly strong, but we never really know for sure how powerful he is or how in control he is of his situation. And part of that comes from the fact that he seems to keep the same sort of cocky, optimistic attitude no matter who he's fighting. He'll openly act like he's got everything all planned out, even when he's being ripped to shreds. Only to reveal that it was all just a ruse to lower the enemy's defenses, but then we'll find out he was actually getting seriously injured. He just constantly keeps you guessing. Later in the show, it becomes a lot more clear just how powerful he actually is, and I honestly think that kind of takes the fun out of him a little bit. Though they do make up for it by including a lot of juicy emotional details about his backstory, including one especially heartbreaking episode where he has to relive the darkest part of his past over and over. The story is also really great. The pacing is just perfect. It never feels like we're spending too much or too little time with any one character or story arc. Every time one is over, I want to see what's going to happen next. I especially want to give props to the climax of season 1, where Elizabeth gets captured. Yeah, I guess I did technically just spoil that, but come on, that was like bowling pins waiting to be knocked over. This climax actually kinda reminded me of the Soul Society arc in Bleach, where you have all these escalating fights going on centered around saving this one particular character, and you care about what happens in every single one of them. All building up to the reveal of some greater new threat that everyone has to band together to try to stop. If I had to name some problems with the show, I guess there are a couple things that kind of annoy me. Like, there is this really stupid running joke with Meliodas trying to grope Elizabeth, and she doesn't really act upset, she just kinda acts flustered and embarrassed. I guess this doesn't piss me off quite as much as when other anime do this sort of thing, because whenever they do it, they only focus on it for a couple seconds. But it's still really stupid and immature, and not in a fun way like the rest of the show. There's also a few different shounen tropes that I can tolerate, but I don't exactly like. For example, whenever a character uses a new move, they insist on flashing a title card with the move's name on the screen. Does that really add anything? It also gets a little annoying in the second season when they start never shutting the fuck up about characters' power levels. Yeah, it's like Dragon Ball Z, where every character's fighting ability can be boiled down to a single simple number. And then they even start dividing it into subcategories, like magical power and physical power. Like, come on guys, this is an anime, not an RPG game. But all the issues I have with this show are really more pet peeves than actual serious problems. I still think this is a really great show. The characters are definitely the best thing about it, and they're what elevate this show from being more than just a bunch of silly over-the-top nonsense. But even when it is just being silly nonsense, it's still a ton of fun, while still being grounded with enough heart and humanity that you do care what happens. It definitely deserves to be as big a hit as it was, and I'm looking forward to future seasons. This is ShadowACS, and I'll see you next time.